Bank analyst Josh Rosner called the credit crisis and the housing bubble before they brought global markets to their knees. And now he's got a warning for Greece. Guess what, Greece? You don't want to be Argentina. He wrote in today's Wall Street Journal, quote, unless there is a renewed commitment to partner with rather than alienate private investment, Greece and the Eurozone will likely face the same fate as Argentina. And that's not a good one. Josh Rosner joins us right now. Matt McCormick of Ballinger still with us. Josh, welcome to the show.
Thanks for having me.
Are they really on that path?
Well, at this point, they are on that path. They're saying that they're not willing to accept the package. Their voting is obviously not supportive of them accepting the package. The population is really demanding a government that respond with more populist answers. That's very much what gave us six different presidents in Argentina right before they ended up defaulting. And it's a problem because, unlike Argentina, which has vast natural resources and at least was able to export, Greece really has few. And so the problems of Argentina, which is isolation, they've had to do more and more by way of snubbing international capital, avoiding foreign direct investments, and turning more inward, really does become the same fate as Greece. Or Greece faces that same fate, unless they really were to recognize that staying in the euro, making the attempts at austerity while demanding greater growth incentives throughout the eurozone is the better alternative.
Walk me through exactly how this happens. If Greece suddenly wakes up, you know, next week or next month and says, all right, time for us to pull out. Or if the EU says, okay, we have no choice here, we got to kick you out because it's just not working.
Which I don't think is possible.
No, well, and perhaps you could argue that it's maybe worse for the EU if they have to do that.
Right.
But if in fact Greece pulls away, what about all the commitments that they already have? All the businesses, for example, that are in Greece that have loan agreements and contracts
Absolutely.
That are already in euros. What happens to all
well,
that?
Well, you end up seeing ultimately a default, a devaluation. You end up looking in that way very much like Argentina. And you have to find, if you're going to default, there has to be a path back into the international community. And for Greece, with no natural resources of or exports of substance, it's likely to be a very, very long and lonely walk in the wilderness for them before they can even think about coming back. And at some point, they're going to have to make good with their international creditors, those contractors, utility providers, et cetera, before capital markets will ever bring foreign direct investments back to their shores.
If you were a Greek citizen right now, would you say that this whole EU deal was a failure? And the worst thing you could have ever done for your country's economy was to join the EU in the first place?
Well, you would certainly say that Greece wasn't prepared to join the EU. And you certainly take the view that they, at this point, are way in over their heads. But that doesn't mean that the default and exit is going to be the easier path than actually working towards austerity and hoping that the European Union puts together a real growth package on the other side.
Argentina, Brazil, Mexico all had to restructure.
That's right.
Argentina, obviously struggling. Brazil, Mexico, very different route. What have Brazil and Mexico done differently that Greek perhaps should be doing?
The big, big difference is their willingness to recognize the value of international capital, the willingness to partner with foreign and bring in foreign direct investment, the willingness to make good on prior credits and make creditors feel that they were going to be treated safely, and that foreign direct investment led to significant investment in infrastructure. Argentina hasn't had that. Brazil has.
Josh, what's the end game for Greece? What can they do considering they can't pull themselves out of the EU? Can they just walk away, or you're looking at continuing morass for a while?
Yeah, no, they can walk away. I don't believe that they can be kicked out. I don't think there's a mechanism for them to be kicked out. And more than that, I think the pro-Euro Germans don't really want to be seen as the ones kicking them out. I don't think the ECB wants to pull the plug on them. So it really is in the Greeks' hands for the most part. The bigger problem, obviously, as we all know, goes beyond Greece. And so Greece, to some degree, has a certain amount of power that I expect that they're going to try and use to pressure the Troika,
Blackman.
To pressure the ECB, to keep them in or to keep them on the austerity path. The problem is I don't think there's much room and much willingness for the Europeans to bend to Greece.
Really quick, David Einhorn at a conference today saying that France could default, that you shouldn't rule that out. Everybody's focused on Spain, everybody's focused on Italy, Portugal, but he said you might want to be looking at France.
Well, I mean, I think ultimately he's right, but ultimately that's part of the collapse of the entire European the Eurozone. I think we've got to worry about Italy now, really primarily. Third largest
more than
debtor
Spain.
Country. Well, yeah, Spain can muddle through for a while. The banks are obviously an issue, but you've got really the third largest debtor country in the world, and no clear direct path out for them either.
All right. J.P. Morgan's $2 billion trading loss gave politicians plenty of fodder in a hearing on Capitol Hill today. But what do you do about that? What do you do about this? That's the real question. Do you stick with Dodd-Frank, with Volcker? Do you get rid of it? Do you turn the clock back, perhaps, about 80 years to the Banking Act of 1933, otherwise known as Glass-Steagall? That is the question we are asking in today's Reaganomics. Bank analyst Josh Rosner of Graham Fisher, he's back with us. Matt McCormick back with us as well. And do either of you think that's the way to go? I mean, has it come to this that we need to separate investment banking from commercial banking and basically see a new version of Glass-Steagall?
Well, I'd look at, first off, Dodd-Frank is a mess. It's an abomination. It's not something that is adding certainty to the market. And when you look at what happened with J.P. Morgan, you look at what's happening with the banks, they're kind of operating with a playbook that the pages literally are still being written as we discuss this. And I think what the bankers need, what the market needs, is a degree of certainty that brings back confidence, and so investors can understand and have better expectations of how they operate.
But would Glass-Steagall give them that?
I think it has worked in the past. You separate the mom and pop versus the casino aspects of the investment side that have not worked, that add more volatility to the market. I don't like too big to fail. If you get somebody that plays fast and loose with essentially my funds, and if they go out and they go bankrupt, that's on their dime, not mine,
okay.
Not the
well,
government.
This is what I would say, and I'm curious what you'd have to add to this, Josh, but you know, you would definitely make the politicians feel happier, right? And you'd make people who are putting their money in their checking account at places like J.P. Morgan feel a little happier. But the reality is, I don't think you're going to change the risk equation. Let's not forget Lehman Brothers, Bear Stearns. Well, those were both the casino-like banks that you're talking about. And they created enough problems in 2008 to take everything
they
down.
They did. They were public companies. Remember Lehman and Bear, when they were partnerships, risk management and risk culture really were the drivers of the day of most of the investment
bank
partnerships.
So you think that's the issue,
public versus private? I think that's a big part of the cultural difference between a commercial bank and an investment bank historically. Now, the two big to fail banks, I don't know how you go back to Glass-Steagall. Operationalizing that would be an impossibility. That said, you do have to recognize that two big to fail institutions are a threat. They should be in narrow banking. They should have very strong limits on the businesses that they could be in, or the assets they could be in. Otherwise, they should have, as over certain size, a significant capital surcharge requirement on them.
Okay, but suppose you do that, right? What's to prevent something like long-term capital happening? I mean, long-term capital wasn't the size of these huge commercial
investment banks. It wasn't the size. It wasn't the size, but it was the leverage.
Right, it was the leverage.
That blew them up. It was the leverage, ultimately, that has really
caused
all of
these. So do you not
allow
leverage?
I think when you look at...
Well, do you not allow risk?
Do
we outlaw risk?
We don't outlaw risk, but we recognize that banks, depository institutions, serve a social utility value as well. And so, really, the ROE and the ROA shouldn't be that far apart based on
social utility value in banks. Okay, Josh, you got me there because as an investor and as a free market capitalist, I don't think about social utility.
But I don't really think of the too big to fail banks as free market players. If they were, you would have seen collateral calls against J.P. Morgan after this $2 billion hit, which you didn't really see. Why? Because there's an assumption that, like Fannie and Freddie, they're implied government guarantees.
Okay,
that's very different.
And that's a problem.
That's very different than the smaller community
banks. And the banks are being forced to reach for risk because they can no longer make money in the traditional ways that they have. And I think if you break them up and you say, we have A, B, and C, and we know what your deal is, and we know exactly where the risks are, I think you can break them up. My point is that you have essentially five or six banks that control the majority of the banking interest, the majority of the derivatives business. And as J.P. Morgan indicated, they still don't know what happens. And when you look at that, and I get concerned as an investor, I get concerned as a taxpayer, I don't want to be holding to five or six entities. I'd rather break them up and you can quantify
and
categorize.
So we need smaller banks. We need
That's right.
banks.
Yes. And in Canada, there's five or six banks that control the majority of the marketplace, and they didn't have Alt-A and subprime. They don't have the derivative risk as we have here.
Though they do have risks in front of them. Now, I would argue that the vibrancy of our system has been the fact that you have state and federal charters, and the regulated smaller state
regional banks have operated more safely. One goes down, it doesn't really affect them all. The interconnectedness is the big issue. The leverage is the big issue. And at the too-big-to-fail institutions, the argument is always, well, but we wouldn't be able to serve the needs of our customers. Well, that's a false argument. That if you remember, syndicated loans, right. Syndicated deals was the way that Wall Street did business.
Well, before. We can all be assured we're going to see more talk about this on Capitol Hill, more talk of regulation in the coming weeks and months, especially as we head into an election season. Josh Rosner from Graham Fisher, thank you so much.
Thank you.
Appreciate it. And a special thanks to you. We loved having you on the program, Matt. We hope to see you back here soon
thanks.
As our guest host today on Street Smart.